time travel is a subject often explored in sci-fi, and for good reason. It offers an endless amount of possibilities for the story to develop, and an equal amount of opportunities to torment its characters. Given its esoteric nature, the interpretations can be quite various, ranging from paradox-causing predicaments to ones more grounded in reality. Well, as much as they can be. I was surprised to find Steins Gate, while operating in a medium that pushes the boundaries of the absurd, to be part of the latter. It was exhilarating to watch something that didn't just regurgitate scientific-sounding nonsense, but instead of its plot be rested upon a foundation of something resembling scientific theory. Kurosu gives a speech at the start of the visual novel, explaining several theories of time travel, and each one is an existing proposal for the phenomenon. Okay. She mentions that out of all the theories, 11 of them are widely accepted in academia, one of which is the same one that Steins Gate seems to adhere to, the black hole theory. The show is surprisingly scientifically accurate, almost enough to fall under the umbrella of hard sci-fi, a genre of science fiction that places an emphasis on real-life plausibility. From the many worlds
It starts off and they're talking about string theory in this class. And she's like, she's a string theorist. How cool is that?
That's pretty good.
Black holes, to the concept of strange attractors, the show utilizes a lot of what we understand about physics and quantum mechanics today. First things first, however, we should define some terms. Time travel typically falls into one of two categories of temporal mutability, mutable or immutable. This simply refers to whether or not you can actually affect the timeline through time travel. If time is immutable, then the past, present, and the future are one.
Okay, we're already venturing into misinformation and just BS territory because no, time travel is something physicists sometimes try and do for fun, but it's not a very serious area of research because one big elephant in the room, which most people not in physics don't understand, is time is not a well-understood concept, nor is it really understood at all. Like, you can understand it in separate theories, like established theories like general relativity or quantum theory, but they're different. And so, you know, talking about time travel, you have to give context to what the fuck you're talking about. And, you know, and then there's just the time in, you know, coming from it, statistical mechanics, thermodynamics perspective and entropy. But that one is probably the hardest one to talk about because it's sort of very abstract. But let's continue. I'm just saying Spidey senses are already like ringing because it's like the way he's talking about it, you know, it's just not how you do it.
An entity. If you change the past, you would have already experienced the effects in the present. There's a story I read back in middle school that uses this concept. Two teenagers have to travel back to the past to stop Hitler, because the only reason the Allies win World War II...
Do you see what I mean, Finn? Like, he's just talking about, like, as if this is just a... you know, if you're going to talk about time travel, you're really going to have to first explain what time is. And no one can do that. So what do you think? It's not sounding good, is it? Yeah, it's like, yeah. This guy's like, travel back in time. It's like, man, like, there's so much
things to think about, but it's like the physicist in me, like you were saying, that the overarching umbrella hat of experiment. You can't run an experiment backwards in time. Like, I can't prepare an experiment and get results before I prepare the experiment. So until you could actually do that, you can't prove or disprove any theory. So all of it is basically pseudoscience. Yeah, yeah. Like,
but there's no even like theory either, like, you know, people claiming this theory of just kooks and wackos, basically.
I wouldn't dismiss them, but it's just like
they absolutely should be dismissed. Like, you, if we can't even explain time, to take this seriously is just adding complexity to something that's already, we don't understand the complexity of. It's like, there are so many people out there that want to like think about time in from a quantum, a loop quantum gravity perspective, and it's like, dude, that is, you know, trying to connect general relativity and quantum field theory. We don't even know if that it works. Loop quantum gravity is a very sort of alternative version of, you know, connecting it, which not many people buy. And then you want to talk about time travel in loop quantum gravity or just time in general. And that's what that Carlo Rovelli guy does. And I think he's awesome, but he doesn't give enough context when he's talking about it. He's not telling people that he's basically lying to them. You know, he's not saying, hey, this is a very hypothetical area, which we don't even know if it's real. And I'm just going to now start talking about time and take you along for this talk about time, but not, you see what I mean?
Yeah,
It's frustrating. Very frustrating for me.
It's because they went back to the past to stop Hitler. Confusing, right? The problem with temporal immutability is that it brings forth a lot of paradoxes. If the kids already stopped Hitler, then they would have no reason to go back to the past in the first place. Primarily, the issue is with causality. And a lot of
there are a lot of paradoxes in physics. They're a good place to look to find new physics. And there's a lot of paradoxes, which are actually what we call physics now. Like superposition sounds like a paradox, but it's not. It's just that the quantum world doesn't behave. There's no analogy to our physical world. So how did we figure it out then? Experiment. So talking about it, this guy is just talking about it like philosophically. It's like, that's a paradox. Yeah, but guess what? Reality can do whatever it wants. And, you know, that's why we use experiment to, like, what I'm saying might sound counterintuitive right now, but this is literally what you do in physics. You have to do experiment. So it doesn't matter if there's a paradox there, essentially. You know, we don't understand how this stuff works. And if you're not going to even give the perspective of what you're talking about, like, he's clearly talking about general relativity now, that perspective. But that's very different to say, like, if you're going to start talking about the standard model of particle physics, you know, and quantum field theories.
Stories that involve time travel either have to work around this or they ignore it entirely. Harry Potter is one that comes to mind. Fortunately, Steins Gate mostly sidesteps this problem by having its timeline be mutable. As you can see, with every D-mail that Okabe sends, the new present he finds himself in is drastically different. Steins Gate...
So just for another reference, Finn, in the show, they definitely take a general relativity approach because they talk about world lines a lot and there's all this... And they're mixing general relativity and quantum field theory all the time because they're mm-hmm. talking about CERN and black holes created at CERN. But basically CERN, right? But if you're going to mention CERN... You're talking about particle physics and quantum field theory. But then they talk about time from the general relativity perspective, world line. These things are not connected yet. Standard model of particle physics wraps up three of the four fundamental forces in the universe, right? Three of them. It doesn't include gravity. We don't even know how gravity fits into, you know, the standard model of particle physics or how it interacts at the atomic scale. So this is why, you know, just bringing those two and confusing them is a bit of a no-no currently.
It accomplishes this by using the many worlds interpretation. In the many worlds interpretation, there are an infinite amount of parallel universes where the events in our past that did not happen, did happen. And the way Steins Gate applies this interpretation is really...
What do you think about that? But what he just said, like, he just claimed the many worlds interpretation means in the past everything has happened. And it's like, that's not what it does. Like what the guy just said about... I'm just sort of responding to what this guy is saying, not in the show. And what the guy just said doesn't make sense. Like, that's not... So that is now established. This guy doesn't really know physics, and he's kind of just talking about stuff, you know? Like, he's Googled it.
So what he's talking about is he goes back in time, and he makes changes to time, and he comes back to the future, and things are different?
No. He was just talking about the many worlds interpretation of quantum mechanics. And he said, that means in the past, everything has happened. Like, I just meant that one line. Like, it's like, that's enough for us to go, okay, this guy is just sort of talking. You know, it's not like, that's not what it says. The many worlds interpretation is hyper-specific about the collapse of the wave function. And there's very, very, very little we can say about it. That's why it's an interpretation. And there's multiple interpretations. And there's no one agrees on it in physics. So it's like... going beyond the a few little things you can say about the wave function collapse and whatever. And then this guy just goes to, that means everything happened in the past. It's like, no, it doesn't.
Really quite ingenious. When someone receives a D-mail, the timeline that Okabe resides in and the one where the D-mail is received are now fundamentally incompatible. The past is information that it should not have. In an effort to resolve the resulting paradox, the timeline shifts into the so-called correct one, where the change past event did happen. Steins Gate refers to these infinite universes as world lines, borrowing the infamous John Titor's terminology. Just to be clear...
Okay, so now it is venturing into, like, what's happening in the anime, and you might be like, okay.
And the show does clarify this. Only one world line exists at any given moment. The others are simply mathematical probabilities, an endless sea of what-ifs, waiting to be summoned into existence through an inadvertent D-mail. On that subject, how is it possible for a text message to be sent back in time in the first place? The anime takes some liberties with this, but essentially Okabe and his future gadget lab unintentionally create a Kerr black hole generator. The specifics are a little complicated, but essentially his phone microwave, name subject to change, generates black holes that are stabilized by electrons emitted by Mr. Braun's eponymous Braun tubes. John Titor, the actual John Titor from the event in our world, asserted that this was the method through which his own time travel machine worked. In the beginning, Okabe and company are only able to send text messages, the average size being about 140 kilobytes or so.
So a Kerr black hole is a rotating, a spinning black hole. I'm just thinking how much to go into this. You know, you couldn't stabilize a black hole with electrons. That's absurd. Take it anywhere near that thing, beyond the event horizon. And yeah, electrons are going to go bye-bye. And I was in the show, they also talk about how there's microscopic black holes are being created at CERN, which was, you know, some kind of ideas that came out before CERN that we might create. But no, we didn't. Because we're being hit with energies from cosmic rays that are much higher energies than we're dealing with at CERN, right? And we're pretty sure we're not being pelted with microscopic black holes. We could be, and they're just evaporating very quickly. We could be making them and evaporating very quickly, but we should see that. Like, we should see some behavioral stuff with the particles. And so far, it's like, it doesn't look like it.
Eventually, however, Kudasu works some magic and Okabe is able to send himself back, or the contents of his brain, rather, with a time leap machine. The human brain is thought to be able to store 2.5 petabytes of data, an astronomical increase compared to a lowly text message. It would be inaccurate, however, to refer to the timeline of Steins Gate as being completely mutable. The show also introduces the idea of attractor fields, collections of world lines that have events that cannot be changed or prevented. Suzuha brings up the example of string. String is composed of many strands, but they all end up heading towards the same direction. What's incredible is that attractor fields actually exist as a concept in science. It's used in the context of dynamical systems, and how some systems tend to move towards the same set of numerical values, even with disturbances and wide starting conditions. For a very simplified example, you can think of a pendulum. No matter how high you begin the swing, it always converges to a single point. Here lies the central conceit of Steins Gate and the whole reason for Okabe's suffering. In the anime, we follow three main attractor fields, the beta field, the alpha field, and of course the Steins Gate itself.
Any thoughts on this? I've never heard of an attractor field.
Yeah, I mean, his example of the pendulum.
Doesn't make
I don't
want
to
sense.
Get on the bagging train, but it goes back to its original position because of gravity. But what if I had okay, you could have a pendulum suspended by an electric field. It's not going to, say it's the string itself is polarized or something. It's not going to go back to its original position. Or, you know, if you had a perturbation of any kind, he's saying, attractor fields, it's all going to go back to its original position. If you perturb a pendulum, which is what these attractor fields would be doing, as he's said before, it won't go back to its original position. It will be perturbed off it, won't it? I don't know.
Yeah, I'm not sure about these attractor fields.
I'm nitpicking his example, though. I've just never heard
he's, I think he's pulling that something before. That's just an idea, like some
silly
concept. If I
Google attractor fields?
Some concept that someone's like, oh, this might be a... But I've never, this isn't something that's hard physics. It would be just something in math.
Yeah, no, it is. In the mathematical field of dynamical systems, an attractor set of states towards which a system tends to evolve. So it's how you have chaos theory and things can go from chaotic to an ordered system over time.
Yep.
That is a potential example.
That's not the universe we live in, though. It's going the other way. Entropy is increasing. Disorder is increasing. So we're going from order to chaos and complexity. There was a new piece of news yesterday. They showed that black holes might actually outlive the heat death of the universe. And they come up with an analog for Leonard Susskind, for the second law of thermodynamics. Finn, I just wanted to tell you this. And they're calling it the second law of quantum complexity. It's an analog for entropy always increases because it's classical. So this is a quantum analog. And basically that complexity always increases. And they if you go read about the paper, they're trying to formalize a new law, which is really cool. I'm not sure if it's going to work, but it's fun shit. Coming back to this, why that's a big no-no, what he's just done, is because he's just pulled a concept from math, which is not the same as physics, and applied it to physics. And physics, we said earlier, the arbiter of truth is experiment. This is why you can't just pull something from math. It's you can, but you'd call that theoretical physics because it's there's no... if it was physics, it means we have evidence. In this universe, that's what's happening. It could be. We did one Google search and it said mathematical thing, right? Maybe there is some evidence that this is happening. But if there is, it's probably general. Because that sounds like a very complex, complex system science, where things tend to go in that general direction. So... Interesting, but
I don't know.
We start off in the beta field, where Kurosu is gruesomely murdered after the conference. By inadvertently sending a D-mail to Daru, Okabe exceeds the divergence margin of the beta attractor field, and he's thrust into the alpha field, where he has to witness Mayuri's death time and time again. Finally, Okabe figures out how to avoid both Mayuri and Kurosu's death, resulting in the titular Steins Gate, as well as the ending that actually allows us to finally breathe again. The question is, just how does Okabe accomplish this feat? Remember how earlier I said Steins Gate only mostly sidesteps issues of causality? So sending a D-mail that is enough to change the past creates a new world line. However, when Okabe is trying to save Kurosu, he doesn't use D-mails. He physically goes back in time with the use of the time machine. His first attempt to save her fails horribly, and this is what sets up the upcoming Steins Gate Zero. Where the issue comes up is a strange message he receives in the first episode. This message is sent from Okabe himself from the future within the same world line. But the reason it's all staticky at first is because the Okabe that sends it doesn't exist yet. You see the problem? This is where Steins Gate Zero comes in. The first time Okabe tries to save Kurosu and fails...
Doesn't exist yet. So this is another where, you know, going before you even talk about this stuff, you have to get which landscape are you in, which perspective, because say you're in general relativity, well, guess what? That's just determinism. You know, like things are predetermined. The past and the present are but a stubborn illusion. And you have this thing called the block universe. So, you know, saying it doesn't exist yet, but you're talking about world lines, which is a general relativity thing, he's confused again. You know, it's like, actually it does. The past does exist in general relativity. But now if we step over to quantum field theory, the standard model of particle, which is not connected, then you could, because we don't really know what's going on there with this stuff.
He doesn't have future Okabe to help him. We'll call this guy Okabe Beta. He breaks down and gives up entirely, and after everything he's been through, I don't blame him. Okabe Beta is the one that makes it to the future and sends the keys to the kingdom to true Okabe, the secret to getting to the Steins Gate timeline. Steins Gate Zero will focus on Okabe Beta's journey to that point, and all the trials and tribulations he'll face along the way. With the existence of Steins Gate Zero, technically this means there's a new Watch Order. Now, I wouldn't recommend it to new viewers unless they're a complete masochist, but it could be an interesting experiment for rewatchers. You'd start with episodes 1 to 22 of Steins Gate, transition into the alternate episode of 23, complete Steins Gate Zero, watch the original episode 23, and then finally get sweet, sweet closure out of episodes 24 and 25 of the original series. Your heart would probably be in pieces by the end, but it'd be interesting to say the least. It was really cool to watch Steins Gate and actually recognize some of the concepts they use in the show. While there certainly are elements that don't quite fit within the realm of science, like Okabe's reading Steiner ability, Steins Gate stands upon a solid foundation of scientific theory. It uses the many worlds interpretation to its fullest potential, resulting in the soul-crushing depression of watching Okabe break into tiny pieces. Its proposed method of time travel is actually somewhat plausible, at least in theory. And the way it ends both wraps things neatly in a bow, while also being open-ended enough to give us the gift of more Steins Gate through Steins Gate Zero. For rewatchers, I encourage you to...
I think he's kind of redeemed himself. The way he was talking about it then was pretty good. Like, he sounded like someone in science and physics, and now it's believable that he could be. And he just sort of hasn't got far enough along the physics advanced courses yet to know he's confusing some stuff. Because it's advanced stuff, talking about general relativity and quantum field theory and how it's related. But he certainly sounds now like a physics student to me. What do you think?
I need to watch the film or the TV.
I'm just talking about what he's saying, though, right? I don't mean like what he's talking about, but the way he's talking.
I think it makes sense.
Yeah, he sounded okay there. Like, I think we're pretty much finished.
He suffered through the new Watch Order with me. We all know the ending is well worth it. Thanks for watching, and be sure to like and subscribe for more content.
So the first 10 episodes, there was like not much on time travel. There was a lot of talking about really sciencey things, which a lot of really good sciencey stuff. So I think you should watch it, Finn, if you're ever bored.
Yeah.
Because it's actually the time travel and these what's going on. It's like it doesn't tell you. And at like episode 10, it was just starting to sort of touch on that. But I was really enjoying it.
Cool.
I was loving
it. Okay. I have a look.
But anyway, my friends, I think that should that could do it.